trying to kill some time until 11:25. Amen. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse number 1. Once you have it, let me know by saying I got it. The Bible says, Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who reside as aliens scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, Bithynia, who were chosen according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, by the sanctifying work of the Spirit, to obey Jesus Christ and be sprinkled with his blood. May grace and peace be yours in the fullest measure. Let's read one more verse. Bless. Everybody say bless.
Bless.
Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his great mercy, God moved something in you, who according to his great mercy has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor. Now this is friends and family day. This time I want you to look at them, talk to them like you know them. Tell them, say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
You can.
You can.
If you want to.
If you want to.
Look at your other neighbor and say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
I know that's right.
I know that's right.
Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Let's pray together. Great God of heaven, we come this morning to say thank you for being such a mighty good God. Lord, you are good, you are great, you are greatly to be praised. If David were here praying in my stead, he would say, from the rising of the sun until the going down of the same, Lord, you are worthy of our prayer. So Lord, before we ask you for anything, we just want to say thank you for everything. Lord, thank you for the sun that shines. And thank you for the rain that we see. Lord, thank you for the times that we're on the mountaintop. And thank you for the times that you lead us through the valley. Lord, thank you for our good days. And thank you for our bad days. Lord, thank you for the air we breathe. Thank you for the shoes on our feet. Lord, we're grateful for the clothes on our back. But Lord, not just for those temporal things. Lord, thank you for your grace. Lord, thank you for your mercy. Above all, Lord, today we want to say thank you for the soul-saving message in the gospel of Jesus Christ. For without it, Lord, we would not have hope but life eternal. But because of what you did and what you accomplished through your Son on the cross that is called Calvary, Lord, we will forever be grateful. Lord, bless this beautiful church and bless the angel of this house and his family. Lord, would you wrap your arms around them and keep them in only a way that a God like you can. Now, Lord, in this preaching moment, we ask that you will come in this room, that you will fill it with your presence, Lord. Show up and show out, not just in this sanctuary, but Lord, show up in our hearts, so that when we leave this safe place, we'll take you with us, and the people that we encounter will be made better because we were in this place on this day. Bless the preacher, and bless the people who sit in the pew, that collectively we might be good stewards of your word, so that one day we'll reap that reward and hear you say, well done, thy good and faithful servant. Now, Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary here in holy trial and truth, that I might be a living testimony just for you in the matchless name of Jesus. And every child of God say, amen.
Amen.
And amen. One month, 3 weeks, and a day. That was the time between Passover and Pentecost. 50 days. 50 days, that was the time God used to do something unpredictably powerful in the life of one apostle who we know as Peter. In 50 days, there were two Jewish festivals. You may remember the first festival, the Passover. I know the Passover may not move you like it moved Peter. But the Passover was a pilgrimage festival where Jews from all over the world would come from wherever they were to Jerusalem to celebrate what the Lord has done. I want to submit to you early in my sermon this morning that every now and then you and I ought to just come together to celebrate what the Lord has done. Now, I'm one of those preachers who I try not to preach real hard, but every now and then it'd be good to me. And when I think about what the Lord has done, that does something to me. It sends chills down my spine. When I think about how good the Lord has been, and when I think about how he has indeed been a bridge over troubled waters, when I think about how the Lord has been a shelter in the time of storm, when I think about how the Lord fed me when I was hungry, how he clothed me when I was naked. When I think about what the Lord has done, my soul cries out, hallelujah. That's where these Jews were every time they came to Jerusalem to celebrate the Passover. Y'all remember the Passover, don't you? Passover was that holiday where they celebrated what the Lord had done, how God sent Moses down to Pharaoh's house, how Moses would knock on Pharaoh's front door and say, the Lord sent me to tell you, let my people go. Moses met a man named Pharaoh who was a lot like most of us. He was hard-headed. Y'all don't have no hard-headed folks down here in Houston, do you? He was hard-headed. Hard-headed, the Bible says that the Lord hardened his heart so that Pharaoh would not obey Moses. And so God sent 10 plagues. Y'all remember the story, don't you? And the first one, Moses did, that Pharaoh was hard-headed. He didn't comply. Second one, he wouldn't comply. Third one, all the way up to the ninth one, but Pharaoh still would not comply to him. Then God said, I know I'm going to get you now. God says to Pharaoh, to Moses rather, go down there and tell everybody to find you a sacrifice. And when you sacrifice the blood of that first one, I want you to rub it over the doorpost. Y'all act like y'all ain't never been to Sunday school around here. And they put that blood over the doors. And because God was going to send his death angel. Y'all, I'm trying to help y'all early in the sermon. The death angel would come, and if you were not covered by the blood, y'all must not preach about the blood around here. If you were not covered by the blood, then the death angel would take your firstborn. I thank God this morning, not for just the car I drive. I can't get no help in here. I thank God not just for the house that I live in. I thank God not just for the degree that's on my wall behind my desk. But today, on this beautiful Sunday morning, I came to say thank you for the blood. The blood gives me strength. From day unto day, I'm not ready to preach yet. The blood, you and I are strange, because if we would have gone down to Egypt to get God's people after 400 years of bondage, we would have been looking for a certain type of person. We would have been looking for people who looked like they were from Wakanda. You know? A certain kind of person. We would have been looking for dark skin or brown skin. We would have been looking for coarse hair and kinky hair. We would have been looking for somebody who looked like us. Y'all not gonna help me this morning? Just stay with me for a little while. But after 400 years, you and I, if we really think about it, we could probably imply that the Jews had mixed with the Egyptians, and that the Egyptians probably had mixed with the Jews. And so it would be difficult to tell who was a Jew and who was an Egyptian. But I thank God that he is not like us. Because when God comes, he's not going to look for black folks. When God comes, he's not going to look for white folks. When God comes, he's not gonna look for brown folks, he's not gonna look for red folks, but when God comes, he's gonna come looking for the blood. And I hope that you will hear me when I say today, you ought to be faithful for no other reason than that you have been covered by the blood. It is the blood. There is power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. This blood is the reason why these Jews from all over the world will come to Jerusalem to celebrate how the death angel passed them over. They would come and it was a celebration. But I want you to know that Passover, at this Passover, not everybody that came to the Passover came to celebrate. All of these people came to celebrate, but Jesus came to be crucified. And it's a sad state of affairs when everybody else at the party is having a good time, but you are so anxious, you are so uncomfortable, you're dealing with so much pressure while everybody else is partying that you are sweating drops of blood while everybody else is having a good time. They came to celebrate, but Jesus came to be crucified. You're almost home now. Peter was at this Passover. Yeah. Peter was a lot like most of us, huh? Peter had a past. Looking at me strange. Like you have always worn that fine suit. You always had your shoes shine. Your skirt always matched your purse and your hat and your shoes. No, you have not always been in the sanctuary. Some of us, if you'll be honest with me this morning, have spent some time in the streets. Maybe it's just me and Tucker. We ain't always been these preachers. Y'all know today there was a time in our life, like you said, before you met us and before we met you and before we really found out who the Lord was, that God met us and he changed us. And today we're somebody different than we used to be. Thank God for the blood. See, the blood can take somebody like Peter at the Passover. Y'all don't remember Peter. Peter was a cussing person. Y'all ain't got no cussing saints in Houston. Peter was a fussing somebody. He was a cussing somebody. He was a knife carrier, and he would cut you if you pushed him. Peter was not somebody who always came to Sundays, who always sat on the front row. He didn't always get it right. Peter had a past, and Peter knew what it meant when the preacher said, if it had not been for the Lord who was on my side, ain't no telling where in the world I would be. Peter was like most of us, and you can look at me strange like you ain't got a past if you want to. The devil is a lie. The Bible says that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. You can act holy if you want to, but that suit, that tie, those shoes, that bag, that hat ain't gonna make you no holier than... But Peter had a past, and when Peter came to Passover, his past caught up with him. I can't get no help in here. Y'all ain't never been in a situation where who you used to be caught up with you. Here is Peter now at the Passover celebration. They have captured Jesus. They were bringing him down to this kangaroo court. But they stopped by the fire, and the Bible says Peter was following him from afar. Peter got close enough to see him, and he sat by this fire, and there was this little girl. Y'all remember that little girl? She looked at Peter and said, Peter, don't I know you? Peter said, no, little girl, you don't know me. I don't know who you think I am. So she went on about her business, and Peter went on about his business. About 15 minutes later, the girl showed up again. She said, excuse me, sir. Now, you look real familiar. Ain't you from Galilee? Peter said, now, girl, I told you. I get that all the time. I get that all the time. Who you think I am? And she said, okay, well, you sure? So she went on about her business, 15 minutes later, she came back. Now, I know where I know you from. You from Galilee, and I see you with the Lord. Peter said, you saw this such and such and so. You knew this, and you, y'all read your Bible. The Bible said Peter cussed her because she said he had been with Jesus. That's a sad commentary, preacher, when your past catches up with you. And here's the problem. He was ashamed that somebody knew. He was ashamed that somebody knew who he was. And the story doesn't end there. Peter didn't deny him not just one time, not just two times, but three times he denied him. And the third time, He was so close when he denied him. The Bible says, the gospel account says, he looked at Jesus. And when their eyes met, the Bible said that Peter cried. Peter cried at Passover because he knew he wasn't where he wanted to be. Is there anybody in here today, and friends and family today, who can be honest enough with these beautiful people to say, I'm doing the very best that I can, but I know I ain't where I need to be? Peter denied Christ at the Passover, but 50 days later, at Pentecost, y'all remember Pentecost, don't you? Now, when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all together on one accord in one place. Suddenly there came from heaven a sound as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they was yelling, and the Bible says that they began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Y'all remember this story? And now they were speaking in tongues so much so that the Bible says when this was going abroad and the multitude came together, they said, how can this be? How can this be that all of these Galilean men are speaking and we hear them in our own native tongue? Church, I don't know if the miracle was in their speaking or if the miracle was in their hearing. All I know is that God was working his wonder-working power in their midst. Something happened between Passover and Pentecost. At Passover, Peter was a liar. At Passover, Peter was a cutter. At Passover, Peter denied Christ. At Passover, he couldn't get right. But at Pentecost, see, Peter showed up at Passover, and he showed up at Pentecost. But Peter, the Peter that showed up at Passover, wasn't the same Peter that showed up at Pentecost. I came today to tell you that God did something in the 50 days between Passover and Pentecost that changed Peter's life. And I don't care how far you have been, I don't care what you have done, how dark the places you have been, I don't care who you get it with or what you've done, that God, if God can change Peter in 50 days, then God can change you too. And count out for those of us who have belonged to the household of faith saying stuff like, this is who I am and this is who I've always been. No, baby, the devil is a lie. God did not leave heaven and disrobe himself of divinity. Walk these dusty roads, drag that cross up Golgotha's hill, big cataplatic kind of thorn placed on his head, hang on an old brother's cross so that you can say, this is how I have been and this is how I'm always going to be. No, baby, the devil is a lie. If God can change Peter in 50 days, it don't take you 50 years to grow up. You can grow up like Peter did too. If you want to, yes, you can. You want to. You can stop cheating if you want to. You can stop fussing if you want to. You can stop cussing if you want to. It don't take 25 years. God can do something different in your life in 50 days. 50 days, a lot can change in 50 days. You can be made over again. The songwriter said, make me over again. God, mold me and make me into what you want me to be. It's got to be what God wants to do in your life. And not what you want to do in your life. How did he do it? I'm so glad you asked. This text is tailored to teach us this morning that God did something mighty in Peter's life, but he did it by mercy. Amen. I need some help. As I get ready to take my seat, I need some help because there ought to be a few people in here this morning that know something about mercy. I'm sorry, but I preach to a church every Sunday. People who, there was a time in our life they didn't know who the Lord was. And there were some things that they had done. Brittany, there were some things in their life, some mistakes that they had made, some dark places they found themselves, some jail cells they had been in, some drugs they had smoked, some. Y'all were up in the church on the south side of Houston, but come on in here with me. We ain't always been like this. Amen, somebody. You have been in some situations that if your mama knew about. And you snuck out of some places that if daddy ever found out. But my grandma would say, baby, you can lie to me and you can trick me and you can fool me, but God knows there's an all-seeing eye watching you. Peter was changed by mercy. Mercy is an interesting term. Because what mercy does is mercy keeps you from getting what you deserve. Mercy, one more time. Mercy keeps you from getting what you deserve. I like to say it three times in four words. One for the Father, one for the Son, and one for the Holy Spirit. Mercy keeps you from getting what you deserve. Y'all still haven't shouted yet? Now, for those of you who've been in Sunday school and sitting on Jesus' lap your whole life, your little white lies in the sight of God are as bad as my big old black lies. See, in the church, we pride ourselves because we don't drink no more. We don't smoke no more. We don't club no more. We don't cheat no more. We pride ourselves on what we don't do, but we backbite, and we murmur, and we grumble, and we're envious, and we're filled with jealousy, and we hate people that we sit aside in the sanctuary every Sunday, but we think that our sin ain't as bad as those other folks' sin. So we look down our noses at people, but I've come today to tell you that your righteousness is as filthy rags in the sight of God.
But don't hold your head low, hold your head up high, because this world is not our home. Now, when you know this world ain't your home, you don't care who's in the White House. Hello, but you know this world ain't your home. You don't lose your job fussing about who's in the White House. But he says, in spite of being a stranger, you've been selected. And that ought to be good news for somebody. Because what it suggests to us is that God, before the very foundation of the world, decided to choose you. Y'all not gonna help me? It wasn't because you were so smart. It wasn't because you were so tall and so dark and so handsome. It wasn't because you were so cute. And it wasn't because you got the best education. No, he looked beyond your faults. And he didn't choose you because of you. He chose you in spite of you. That's good news to somebody like me who has made some mistakes. Because if God can do it for Peter, then I know he can do it for me. Is this the same Peter that cut a man? Is this the same Peter that cussed out a little girl? Is this the same Peter that denied Christ not once, not twice, but three times? So how is it that you don't feel like you're qualified for God to use you? And you've been saved for 25 years. And God used Peter in 50 days. First, God was at work in his life with mercy before the foundation of the world. Peter writes to this group of people who are dealing with the problems of life. He wanted them to know that no matter who you are, no matter where you have come from, no matter what you have done or where you have been or what you have seen, God has chosen you. It's good news that God had you on his mind. Literally, that term means that he was plotting and had a plan for you. That's why Jeremiah writes, for I know the plans I have for you. That's good news for somebody who has been through hell and high water. And they won't leave you alone on your job. And your family members are talking about you behind your back. And your friends won't answer the phone when you call and won't respond to your text message. It's good news to know that when everybody else saw the worst in you, he saw the best in you. It's good news this morning. It's good news to know that when everybody else leaves you out to dry, God is counting on you. It's good news to know that when they looked at your son when he was in the fourth grade and told him he wasn't going to amount to nothing, he wasn't going to be nobody, you can tell your fourth grade son who was 10 years old, tell him you a lie, you ain't the truth. The Bible says God has a plan for me. God chose you. And God has chosen you. Not only is he working in your life through mercy that way, he also works in our lives right now. He didn't just work in our past when he chose us before the foundation of the world, but he's working in our lives right now. He uses the term in our text, sanctifying. Can I be honest with you? That's a process. Take your time, preacher. For those of us who have been saved for a long time, let's not forget how far the Lord has brought us. I'm afraid that every now and then we've been Holy Ghost filled, sanctified, set up, and meet for the master's use for so long that when new folks come around, they feel so uncomfortable. Not because of who they are, but because of who we think we are. Sanctification ain't something that happens overnight. Listen, I've been married for 12 years, and I am not the same husband I was 12 years ago. And the first day I said, thank you, Father. I ain't in here by myself. I've been preaching for about 15 years. Lord knows the Lord has brought me a mighty long way. Now let me stop talking about me. Let me talk to you. If you've been saved for a long time and you still in the church,
You ought to say, thank God.
Thank God.
We try this side, y'all look at the screen. If you still know who the Lord is, and you still in your right mind, the Lord has continued to keep you, you still have a roof over your head, you still got your job, you still got your peace, you can sleep at night, you still got your joy, you ought to be able to say, thank God. It's a process that God leads us through. Watch this, your ups and your downs, your valleys and your mountaintops. Everything that happens to you, God does on purpose and with purpose, and it is a sanctifying work to make you and I more dedicated to Him. Church ain't about us. It's about Him. And when we realize that it's not about us, but it's about Him, say it again. When we realize that our heart is not about us, but about Him. When we realize that new job we got wasn't about us, but it was about Him. When we realize that new husband or wife we got, it's not about us, but it's about Him. It'll make our homes a better place. It'll make our schools a better place. It'll make our church a better place when we realize that everything, all the sanctifying work that God does in our life, it does not happen overnight, but it's a process. So church, don't be ready to take my seat, but before I go, listen, He works in our past. He selected us. He is working in our right now, in our present. He's sanctifying us. And then here's where you ought to shout today. I'm not one of those preachers who will promise you that in 3 days God will give you a new car. I don't do that, church. You don't do that. Either. Don't come to my church and preach that sermon right there, church. I'm not one of those preachers that's going to tell you in 7 days He's going to turn your life around. That's not who I am. I'm not going to promise you that He's going to pay all your bills. I'm not going to do that. There's a preacher in my city. Every time I hear him preach, he's making promises on God's behalf that God ain't never made. But the one promise I will make is the one He made a long time ago. That if you will be obedient to the gospel of Jesus Christ, He will save your soul. This sanctifying work, and I'm done, watch this. This sanctifying work, he mentions, you remember we read the text, is the sprinkling of the blood. Now I know y'all church back there looking at me strangely now. Now let me make a public service announcement. There is one Lord, one faith, and one baptism. But when Peter uses this term, sprinkling, that don't prove that you can be baptized by being sprinkled. What Peter is doing is pointing these Jews back to Leviticus chapter 14, when there were some people who were sick with leprosy. And when you were sick with leprosy, when your leprosy had been washed away, if I help somebody, they would lead you to the outside of the city. You would follow behind the priest, and he would take two doves. I wish I had some help in here. And he would, watch this, he would sacrifice one. And he would sprinkle the blood of the sacrifice on the leper who had been cleansed, and he would sprinkle the blood of the sacrifice on the pigeon or on the dove that would fly away. Y'all don't want to help me. So when Peter points us back to Leviticus, what he's saying is that all of us were one time sick and sinking in our sin. I think that the church would be made better if we remember that the church ain't a place for people for no other reason to come than that they are sick in their sin. And for those of us who've been saved for a long time, you need to remember that hospitals are not for folks who are well, but hospitals are for folks who are sick. Hospitals are where people go to be made whole again. No, I'm not going to help you. Hospitals are where people go who realize that if something don't change, they're going to die. But at some point in the hospital, you ought to find your healing in the hospital.
at some time in the hospital, you ought to get made whole in the hospital. At some point in the hospital, your bad news ought to turn into good news at the hospital. Y'all not gonna help me. Watch what happens. So in Leviticus chapter 14, they will sprinkle the blood of the sacrifice on the leper and on the other dove. And when they sprinkled that blood of the sacrifice on the leper, he would walk away made whole again. And when they sprinkle the blood of the sacrifice on the other bird, it will fly away. Now the reason why I wanted to take time to point that out is because there's an old saint in here this morning to say, you know, I may never get the new house, I may never drive a better car, I may never get a raise on my job, I may never get my pie in the sky, I might never get my 40 acres in the moon and a mule, but one of these old days, I'm gonna sing grandma's favorite song, someday morning, when this life is over, I will fly away. I don't know who you are, I don't know what you've been going through, I don't know how long you've been dealing with it, but one of these old days, God is gonna make it better after a while, after a while. You can change if you want to. You know what I discovered? I've been preaching long enough to know that people make time to do whatever they want to do. Yeah. Yes, I have. I've been preaching long enough to know that people got enough money to do whatever they want to do. I've been preaching long enough to know that people volunteer, got time to volunteer to do whatever it is they want to do. I don't believe in this I can't mentality. Listen, I believe you can get another degree. I believe if you ain't got the first one, you can go and get your GED. I believe that God has given us everything we need to take the next step and go to the next level in every walk of our life, not just on my job, but not just in my academic pursuits, but also spiritually. Peter was a different man at Pentecost than he was at Passover. A whole lot can change in 50 days. In 50 days, you took somebody who wouldn't even acknowledge Christ. And in 50 days, that same man who denied him three times stood up and preach the first gospel message. In 50 days, this knife, total, lying, cussing, cutter, became a scripture quote, gospel preacher. And I want you to understand that if God can do it for him, then I know he can do it for you. I gotta get ready to go, but before I go, let me tell you, that's why I'm so happy. That in verse number 3, after he tells you that he saved you, he said, blessed be the God and the Father. Anybody ever just take time out of yourself to just bless the Lord? And every now and then, you ought to wake up in the morning and just have something good to say about God. Every now and then, you ought to talk to your children, and you ought to say, you see this house we live in? That's what the Lord has done. Maybe we can afford to pay these taxes on this side of town, not because they're so smart, but because of what the Lord has done. We put you in this school, not because we make so much, but because of what the Lord has done. Y'all not gonna help me in here? Grandmama may not have had as much education as some of us, but grandmama had enough sense to say, see what the Lord has done. And that's what Peter does. Peter points us back to what the Lord has done. Blessed be the Father of our Lord Savior Jesus Christ. He talks about this salvation that you and I have that has come as a consequence of the gospel of Jesus Christ. So before I extend the Lord's invitation, we always have to ask the proverbial question, what is the existential expediency of the gospel of Jesus Christ. That is, what does the gospel have to say to those of us who meet here but have to live out there? We come in here and we call it a sanctuary, but we live out there in a world where we know that we need to be saved. What does the gospel have to say to somebody who lives at a moment in time with their backs up against the wall? I'm so glad you asked. Here's what the gospel says. If God can erase a crucified Christ from the dead, then God can do anything but fail.
Amen.
I thought you would respond that way. See, they didn't stand him to death. They crucified him. He wasn't hit by a car. He was crucified. He didn't have a heart attack and die. He was crucified. He didn't fall asleep, slip into a coma, and they couldn't wake him up. No, he was crucified. And if God can raise the crucified Christ from the dead, then there's nothing you can go through that God can't raise you up from. If God can raise the crucified Christ from the dead, then you can raise those children if you got to raise them all by yourself. If God can raise the crucified Christ from the dead, I don't care who walks out on you, you need to know that God can raise you up too. If God can raise the crucified Christ from the dead, I know you got pregnant while you was in high school and you didn't get to finish, but if God can raise Jesus from the dead, he can help you get your education too. If God can raise the crucified Christ from the dead, baby boy, I know you went through some things, made some bad decisions, but ended up getting locked up, but if God can get Jesus out the grave, then I know he can get you out of prison. If God can raise the crucified Christ from the dead, there ain't no depth that you can fall. His arms aren't long enough to reach. If God can raise the crucified Christ from the dead, if they fired you, then God can give you another job. If God can raise the crucified Christ from the dead, it doesn't matter that you got laid off. Get in the next round and he'll get you hired over there too. If God the crucified Christ from the dead, I don't care how nasty your divorce was, if you did it for the right reasons, God will give you somebody brand new. If God can raise the crucified Christ from the dead, then God can do anything but fail. And I'm only looking for two or three people in this room that have been to hell and back and know in a very real sense that if God can go to hell and raise Jesus from the dead, then he can come in my hospital room. Listen, it's the gospel. It's the gospel that says if God can go in that tomb, roll that stone away, then all the stones in your way, in your life, he can roll those stones away too. I don't know who I'm trying to help in here this morning, but somebody needs to know he's a God that is bigger and better than any stone that the devil can put in your way in your life. If he can raise the crucified Christ from the dead, there ain't no marriage he can't fix. If God can raise the crucified Christ from the dead, there ain't no children who have lost their righteous mind that he can't help find. And if God can raise the crucified Christ from the dead, he can save your soul. Paul said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, but it's the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. Questions, you got to believe the gospel of Jesus Christ. Listen, God has a design for everything. Have you seen it? Have you seen how the sun rises in the east and sets in the west? That was God's design. Have you ever looked up? I know y'all live in the city, but if you go way out there in the country, Sugar Lady. Look up in the middle of the night, you can see the stars in the sky, the Big Dipper, the Little Dipper. And every night, God did that. If you've ever had the privilege of experiencing being a part of God bringing a child into this world, you know that the only way something can live on the inside of somebody else and then come into a world that they have never known and still survive, God did that. God has a design not just for life, but God has a design for you. The problem is that most of us don't like doing life by anybody else's design. So we depart from God's design, and the Bible term for departing from God's design is called sin. And Isaiah tells us it is your sin that separates us from God. The problem with sin is that sin leads us to a place of brokenness. All of us know what it's like to be broken, don't we? Anybody here ever been disappointed? Anybody ever felt ashamed, not of your situation, but ashamed of yourself? Anybody in here ever been in a place where what you were counting on ran out? Broken. Broken ain't altogether bad. Because here's what brokenness does to everybody who's ever been there. Brokenness leads you to a place where you realize something has got to change. But the problem with brokenness is if you like me, when something is broken, my natural inclination is to try to fix what's broken. The only issue with trying to fix what's broken and do it on your own is typically, when you try to fix it on your own, you end up making it worse than it was before you got involved. And if that's where you find yourself in your life this morning, you have been trying to fix it all by yourself. You know it's broken, you know something has got to change. I got good news for you this morning. God saw it coming. God had a plan for you. He knew that one day you would be in this place for such a time as this. He knew that you would come broken and don't nobody who's sitting around knowing it but you. He knew you would come with all that stuff on your heart, with the weight of the world on your chest. He knew you would come broken. So he sent his son Jesus Christ to die on an old rugged cross. And you, my brothers and sisters, need to know he didn't just die, but he got up from the dead. The songwriter would say, there's an empty grave there to prove that my Savior lived. He raised him from the dead. There it is in you. No matter what you're being broken by, if God can raise Jesus, the crucified Christ, from the dead, he can fix whatever's broken in your life. You got to take a step forward now. The Bible says, but without faith, it's impossible to please him. But he that comes to him must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them who diligently seek him. God doesn't want you to just believe, but he wants you to pursue him. So many of us come into the body of Christ. We take communion every Sunday. We put $20 in the collection plate. Tip in late and tip out early. And we think that that is the circumference of our Christianity. That's not so. Those boundaries are only the beginning. God is not just concerned with whether you're on the inside or on the outside. He's concerned with what direction you're going. You have to pursue him. Not only believe, though, you've got to make a conscious decision to change your life. That's what the Bible calls repentance. And Luke records these words. That there was a time when God winked at man's ignorance, but now he commands all men everywhere to repent. And that's where God makes Christianity personal. See, Christianity is like Islam, where you are born into Islam, but you're not born into Christianity. You got to make a conscious decision to accept Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior.
Now I know that sounds like I stole that from the other side of town, but let me tell you, it was in the Bible before it came out of there. You have to accept him. How do you know? Because Peter told him so. Acts 2:36, therefore let all the house know assuredly that God has made that same Jesus whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. Now when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? I'm so glad you asked. Then Peter said, repent and be baptized, every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of your sins. I don't know where you are in this room. I don't know what change you need to make in your life. But all of us can make that same transition in the next 50 days that Peter did between Passover and Pentecost. But it begins with you submitting your will to the will of God. If you're here today and you desire prayer, why don't you come? If you're here today and you want to give your life to Christ, why don't you come? If you're here today and you want to rededicate your life to Christ, why don't you come as we together stand and sing?
Oh, to Jesus I